Good morning to everyone.
Morning.
I want to welcome anybody that might be attending for the first time on a Sunday morning. We get together every week to share ideas that we can use to improve the quality of our lives. Drawing from psychology, philosophy, religion, parapsychology, psychic research, all of the ologies and the isms. Now, what I try to do is to share with you the groundwork that people normally would take to come to a conclusion, i.e., over a period of nearly now 50 years, I've taught tens of thousands of people and had interaction with these people in regard to what works and what doesn't work. So what I try to share with you here on Sunday mornings is if you took everything from alchemy to Zen or Zoroastrianism, put it together in such a way that you could apply it to improving your everyday life, and that is what comes out here. The idea is that we learn from within ourselves. The great teacher of the universe is only to be found at the very center of all of your minds. At best, any person that speaks about spiritual things can only direct a person back in upon themselves. And that is exactly what we try to do, to get you to a point where there's nothing left but to go into that place where you're going to find all the answers. The answers not being from any teacher that sets themselves up to be some type of god or goddess on earth. All of that is Mickey Mouse baloney. I try to go straight to the truth. I have been doing this for decades, and people that actually wish to make a change or to improve their life don't want a Mickey Mouse around. It's as simple as that. It's like you say, I've had it. I've had enough suffering. I've had enough misery. I've had enough playing spiritual games, going from this religion to that religion, or this occult venture to that occult venture. I've had it. I'm no better off than I was when I started this whole quest. Oh, I got a lot of knowledge up here as far as intellectual knowledge. Big deal, I know what an aura is. Big deal, I know what an angel is. Big deal, I know what a spirit guide is. But if you're still so neurotic, so hung up, that you're not getting anywhere in life, what's the point? The point is that there is a pointing into yourself. Every week, people go through a lot of ups and downs and stresses. So before we get into our main subject, what I'd like to do is to take a few moments, have you sit back in your chairs, either put both feet flat on the floor or your ankles crossed, whichever is most comfortable to you, and we'll take a few moments to concentrate upon the health of our body. So let your eyes close, if you would, and just think along with me for just a few moments. I change my focus from the outer perception of the world around me for a few moments, that I may concentrate inward on the inner perception of that which is within me. For the universe that created me abides within me. The life spark that is the force of universal life, the God of the stars and of the heavens, likewise is the God of my body. There is this tremendous divine intelligence here within me every moment of my life, this moment, and I open every nerve, cell, and tissue to the indwelling presence of the great spirit, the great mind, the great physician that lives here within the body temple that was created by this presence. And so my body, every cell of my body opens wide
to receive the impulse of the divine, to receive the primal light energy of the God of the universe dwelling here within me, God's created temple. And so now I recline back into the gentleness of the love that is God's presence flowing through the entirety of my body, absorbing me in light, in those vibrations of energy that initiate healing, wholeness, and health throughout the entirety of my body, in my head, in my neck, in my upper body, lower body, my arms, my hands, my legs, my feet, everywhere, the healing touch from within of the divine light, the divine mind, the divine spirit that has given me life, created me, and sustains me. I am part of that light, inseparable from that wholeness, inseparable from that completeness. And therefore, if there be any part of my body that is in need of divine healing, that part of my body is open to receive an adjustment of energy, of motion, and of rhythms into every cell. The entirety of my body and mind rests in an inner state of the peace that passeth all understanding, a state of tranquility, calm, balance, and polarity. I am at peace with the God of my being, and a peace exists throughout me. I give thanks to Almighty God's presence living within me, maintaining my health and healing me whenever healing is needed. For this realization of health and healing at all levels of my being, I give thanks. I let it be so. And so it is. This morning's subject is an interesting one. It's one that deals with life spans, yours and others. I'm sure that as a human being goes through this physical life, at one time or another, you wonder about, how long am I going to be here? Sometimes I know that some people say to themselves, my gosh, how did I get through all of these things that I've already been through, and I'm still here? My God, I did this to my body, that to my body. Oh my gosh, I have practically put my body through the mill, and I'm still here. Looking for a miracle? Well, that's the first miracle, isn't it? If you stop to think about what the average human being goes through in a lifetime, it's sometimes a wonder that a person almost looks back in amazement. They wake up in the morning and say, oh my God, I'm still here. Wonder of wonders. Sometimes you fall asleep and you have a fever, you don't feel well, you think to yourself, uh-oh, at least I'll go in my sleep. Sounds better than an accident or something else, doesn't it? I'll just go in my sleep peacefully. We then open up a whole area of interest. Why do some people live only a short amount of time? Why are some people born dead, some souls? Why do other souls turn around and live for many, many years? Why is it that possibly good souls sometimes go quicker than the so-called bad souls that are up to no good? How does all of this make any sense? It can be troubling, as an example. Troubling to a point where even perhaps people who are thought of as being extremely religious tend to question. It was just this week, as an example, that unfortunately some letters from Mother Teresa were made public, in which she expressed enormous doubt in terms of her faith and in regard to even if there is a God. Now, mind you, this is someone who's up for sainthood in a particular religion. And so what we find is that even a person who supposedly is saint-like has doubts in terms of what is this whole thing called life? Why is it that people I see here are suffering? People are dying of starvation while other people are absolutely have their plate so full they can't eat everything. Let's go back for another helping. What is this balance, or is there a balance, or is there an imbalance? Why is it that some people have short lives, desperate lives? Why is it other people that seem to be the bad boys and the bad girls seem to get away with everything, seem to live only self-indulgent lives and go on and live long lives? What's wrong with this picture? Now, of course, in our study, we have always taught that if you think positively, if you meditate every day, you're going to feel better, look better, act better, prosper more, be more loved, etc., etc. And if you're more loved and you're more prospered, probably you're going to live longer because you're going to eat better. You're not going to sit around and wallow in loneliness. And yet, as I've studied over the years the lives of people that really have been spiritual, some of them have not lived long lives. So how do you figure? Where's the sense of weights and balances here? Jesus was once approached, and somebody said to him, you look at all of these people here. They're getting away with this and that and this and that. I mean, what's the justice? And he said, well, verily I say unto you, they already have their reward. Now, to the person looking just out through their five senses, the reward? What's the reward? The reward is this short-lived situation of win a battle but lose the war. Have you ever thought, possibly, that if there is a law of cause and effect, and I think most of you will agree that there is, that this law of cause and effect doesn't allow any of us to get away with anything. For a while, we may win a few battles. But if our heart is not in the right place, if we are lying, deceitful, cunning, using the ways and methods of this neurotic world, then perhaps something, as they say, what goes around comes around, what comes around goes around. It's the law of cause and effect. So, what happens then if we see some poor soul that doesn't have a long life? We feel sorry, because our initial situation, if we have a sense of feeling and heart and spirituality, is to immediately say, if a child is born and immediately dies, stillborn, blueberry, whatever you want to, whatever the cause, you say, oh my gosh, what a shame. What a shame. Now let's look at it, what's really going on here. A soul is attempting to come into and back into this physical life. They're trying to get back in. But yet they're cut off through some physical situation, through abortion, whatever it might be. They're cut off. They don't make it. And if a soul doesn't make it, the soul doesn't cease to exist. It just bounces back to the astral world. There, perhaps, to learn, well, why didn't I get in? Well, what did you do in your last life? What did you do in your previous lives? What I'm trying to say to you here is that there is divine justice where, to our outer senses, there appears to be in nature's oftentimes injustice. Are you following me on this? To our outer senses, it doesn't look sometimes that things, why does God allow this to happen? It happens not because God sets anything into motion, but except for a law of cause and effect. As you sow, so shall you reap. If you're harming other people, whether it's through a physical type of harm where you attack them physically, or whether you're doing something where you're lying and cheating and scheming, same situation. The law of karma, as we call it, catches up. And hence, some people will hardly have a breath of life before they're back headed to the astral world or the in-between state of between lives. So you have this karmic thing, you have this thing of who has done right, who has done wrong, and it cannot escape us. Oftentimes we say, why is a person born with a silver spoon in their mouth? Because this is a part of what they were in the past. Why does a person have this lengthy, healthy type of life? Because of what they were in the past. They did good things. They did good things for others. So when you look at the length of a person's life, there are many things that can cause a measurement of it. You can, as an example, eat the healthiest diet, exercise, do all of the right things that modern medicine will tell you to do, and still drop dead at 40. Now that's the God's honest truth. I met a man maybe about 15 years ago, and he was in his 60s at that time and just was strong as an ox, enormous amount of energy. I said, out of curiosity, what kind of a diet do you have? What do you eat every day? Says, same thing, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. I said, what is this? What's this superfood that you eat? Hamburgers. Hamburgers. Well, where do you get them lean at the market? Oh, no. I go to the fast food. I don't have time to shop. I go to the fast food places. Okay. Here's somebody in their 60s just pushing the envelope. And you say, well, I don't know how much more time this fella has. Hard to say. I have a neighbor that's in their 80s. I can't stand to be around them because they're always smoking. Puff, poof. Hey, did you hear about this? Poof, poof. Did you hear about that? Poof, poof. It's a poof, poof here and a poof, poof there. Poof, poof everywhere. And yet, he's spry. That's not to say that maybe it won't catch up with him with emphysema, lung cancer. I don't know. Maybe it won't. Over years of really looking at life and then mixing it a little bit with what's been brought forth in recent years, we know that there's a physical DNA. We know that. It's almost like our bodies are predetermined, and because we're a psychophysical unit, if our body is predetermined, our mind is predetermined also. One reflects the other. Mind reflects the body, body reflects the mind. So our DNA is both physical and mental. I believe, after a lot of looking into this, and I'm not talking just from the outer scientific standpoint, I'm talking from the inner mystical standpoint of years of meditating between for myself and other students that I've had over the years, looking over the notes and so forth. What I really feel is this, and it's one of the affirmations for this morning, that the physical DNA is the outer manifestation of spiritual DNA. In other words, whatever is physical has a spiritual counterpart. We measure the outer energy frequencies as far as outer physical recorded DNA, but underlying and underscoring that is karma, is cause and effect. So therefore, there is a higher order at work here determining a person's lifespan. And it's born into the DNA. In other words, what I'm also saying here is basically that everything is predetermined, predestined. That's why some people can abuse their body, or you think to yourself, how can they get away with all? Because their DNA is set. On the other hand, you have people who do all the right things and die young. When I was a teenager, we had an expression. It was in the James Dean era and the Elvis era. It was something that went, when I was in high school, it was something that went like, live fast, die young, and have a good-looking corpse. Any of you remember that? A few of you remember that. Okay. It was popular in those days, and it had a particular type of message to it. Now, I believe that everybody is here on Earth because they are supposed to be here. Not one moment longer than they're supposed to be, not one moment shorter than they're supposed to be. So if you're still here, there's a reason. The God presence inside of you is keeping your heart, your lungs, your kidneys, all of your internal organs working, functioning, because you have a reason. You may say, I don't know what my reason is. I'm retired. I go to my room every day. I don't see anybody, talk to anybody. Oh, maybe I say hello to the checkout lady at the market. What's my reason? Your reason is to say hello to the checkout lady. After all, if you haven't been around anybody else, you had nobody to get in any conflict with, so you should be a happy soul when you say, hi, lady, at the checkout market. So that will brighten her day rather than the grouches that are going through, hey, you didn't get my coupon over here. Hey, that thing's on sale. Like she's really in on it with the market. It's the way that things are, and as you go through life, you begin to see that there are changes. Yesterday, as an example, I had a couple of buttons lost from the top of my shirt. Person says to me, oh my God, that looks really, are you trying to be sexy? I said, no. I thought to myself, at my age, I'm just trying to be presentable. I mean, come on. You get to a certain point where it's all maintenance, and that's it. Let's look at the affirmations for today. The first says meditation. It says, I recognize that through my daily practice of meditation on God's presence within me, eventually all mysteries of life are revealed to me. All mysteries of life are revealed to me. Sometimes a person doesn't have to have a formal practice of meditation, but can suddenly slip into a meditative state of mind, spontaneous meditation. I really believe this. I believe that when Martin Luther King said, I've seen the light, I've seen this and that, he knew he was very, very close. Very, very close. It's almost the swan song. I believe that if we have an extra little amount of time to think about it, because we are pre-programmed, that something will begin to kick in, particularly if you are meditating and close to God every day, you'll begin to sense something. I'm not talking about aches and pains. I'm talking about something that is intuitive. And this is not a bad thing, incidentally. You might find yourself making a few more phone calls, saying a few more things. It isn't necessarily, well, it's been a good life, thanks very much. But it is a thing where you begin a sensing process. So when you are meditating every day, you begin to learn the mysteries of life pertaining to why people have long lives, why people have shorter lives. And you begin to learn these, not necessarily that these are things that you want to hear, because from a human standpoint, we may feel that nature is somewhat cruel. Have you ever felt that nature is cruel sometimes? That nature does things, and of course nature is just the outer manifestation of spirit. But have you ever felt that, that maybe there's something that's not right? Yet in the final analysis, if you could see behind the scenes, you would see that everything really is right. And that's sometimes a hard pill to be able to understand and reconcile with it, particularly if you've had somebody close to you that has gone through misery and suffering and heartache. Maybe yourself. It's difficult to keep saying everything is okay. Everything is in divine order. It's hard to use these metaphysical cliches. But when you meditate every day, you not only begin to see why things happen, you begin to see why some of the things that are thought of to be so harsh by nature and God really have an upside or a good side to them, regardless of how much injustice you may feel is taking place. Let's look at the next one. It says, physical DNA. I recognize that physical DNA is the outer manifestation of spiritual factors. Spiritual factors, this is what I mentioned a few moments ago. So now let's take a look. The next affirmation says spiritual factors. I recognize that spiritual factors determining DNA, and in turn the length of a person's life, include but are not limited to karma, lessons to be learned, and contributions to others. Now, you could probably extend that list, but I feel that these are major, major points of why DNA is as it is. So the first is pretty easy to understand for everyone, karma. You pick up on a lifespan based upon the good or the bad in this and previous lives, but primarily previous lives, because the DNA is what you come in with. Lessons to be learned. That's a long haul for the human soul. I don't know how many times people will go ahead and make the same mistake over and over and over and over and over. Have you noticed that? A repetition, same kind of relationships, same kind of daydreams as far as what they're going to do in life. Same thing over and over and over. Now, when we come in, we're supposed to possibly learn certain lessons. The only people that are immune from this are people that have learned their lessons and become world saviors, avatars, highest of spiritual teachers. They're no longer subject to, as they say in the East, the wheel of birth and rebirth. They've bounced out of their karma. Through the light and the essence of God within themselves, they are no longer subject to the things that people are subject to that are still here to learn. As soon as you've learned your lessons for this life, you are out of here. As soon as you have either been rewarded in karma or scolded in karma, you're out of here. As soon as you have contributed what you're supposed to others, you're out of here. It's as simple as that. There's no necessity for you to be here. So, you're homeward bound, back into the light, back into that presence that is God within you. And so when you think of these things, you realize, and you have to ask yourself, well, I knew somebody that only lived so many years. So was it their karma? Was it that they learned their lessons? Or have they finally contributed to others? And the contributions can come in many ways. They can be guised in many, many different types of ways. And so you have to ask, what is it that's going on in my life? When you ask yourself, how long will you live, if you've ever had that question ever enter your mind, you have to ask yourself then, okay, what is the karma that might be keeping me here? Am I resolving it, or haven't I resolved it? What is, or are the lessons that I have to learn in this life? Have I learned them? Am I in the process of learning them? Now, some of you might get real bright and you say to yourself, well, hey, if I can slow this thing down about learning these lessons, I'll be here longer. Strange how the mortal mind works. It's strange how you rationalize that I'll be here longer if I can just slow this process down. If I just don't go ahead and contribute to what I'm supposed to in this lifetime, I'll just stop all my contributing, being good to people. I'll just stay here longer. Well, you can play that game, but it's only a game. And therefore, you'll come back not in good shape in the next lifetime. Let's look at contributions. It says, I recognize that contributions to others include wisdom, healing, positive or negative role-playing, and sacrificing. You might say to yourself, well, why was I born to a certain set of parents? Oh, no chance, no coincidence that some total of your energies over a period of lifetime was drawn to a composite of the mother-father energies of your parents. No coincidence. Everything by divine design. Now, some of you might not like to hear that, because some of you may have had a bad situation with your parents. And I understand that. But you don't go through life blaming your parents. At the same time, you have to find some type of respect for them, as difficult as that might be, if you find that that's the case. Wisdom, what is it that we can give to a child? The greatest gift, wisdom and love. So are we contributing of wisdom or love to somebody? Are we playing out a role of something positive or negative with another person? You know, in metaphysical studies, there's an idea and concept of that we make contracts with people before we come into this life. Any of you familiar with that? Let me see by show of hands. How many of you that just put up your hands believe that? I'm just curious. Same amount of hands. Well, that's the case. That is the case. Everybody that we run into, either casually or long-term in this lifetime, we've known before, deja vu. Back again. So we have to play out a role, positive or negative. They have to teach us something, or we have to teach them something, or it's a mutual learning society. When this thing has taken place sufficiently, then you either die or you go on, because the relationship or your interaction with the person in this lifetime is over. That's why people sometimes move from one city to another, not because another city looks better to them, that's what they think outwardly, but because they're through knowing the people that they knew in this previous city. They're ready to move on. That expression about being ready to move on is a truism. Then it says, I recognize then that the length of a person's life, including my own, is when someone's soul's purpose for this lifetime has concluded. Remember what Jesus said on the cross? Last words? It is finished. It is finished. Meaning he incarnated for the purpose that he incarnated for, a divine mission to bring spirituality to the Western world, and it's finished. And you don't have to be a world savior, that if you're on your deathbed and you have an extra few moments to think before you pass over, you can say to yourself, it's finished. For this time, it's finished. The main thing is that when you go to make that transition, that you do it with a clear heart and with no regrets. And that you have a sense of thankfulness in your heart for everybody that you've known, every person that you've ever loved and has loved you, for all the good that you've experienced, all the laughter, all the joy, all the happiness, all the camaraderie. Those are the things that we take with us because we take our heart with us. We take our soul with us. And it's the nature of the soul to leave this world, hopefully, without a sense of malice or hatred. Likewise, in order to get that way, in case we leave unexpectedly, to be in that state and frame of mind at all times during our life. Then we have old souls and baby souls. Now, all of you have heard about old souls, and then you have baby souls. And it says, I recognize that the length of a person's life is not determined by whether someone is an old soul or a baby soul. An old soul may come in with a mission, a purpose, a message. Give out that message and be gone. Short-lived life, but no less than a person that's a baby soul that might live 100 years because they're just getting used to things. They're just feeling their way around the environment. Generational, I recognize that length of life may be influenced by incarnating as part of a soul energy grouping of souls. That's a very, very interesting thing because every generation is a soul grouping and a certain energy that comes in. It's reflected in the music, the art, and the dress of every generation. It isn't by coincidence that people tend to respond in a particular generation to a certain type of music, certain type of dance, certain particular social interests, particular ways of dressing, expressing themselves, verbiage, whatever it might be. Nothing is by coincidence. So you have groups of souls that come in. Groups of souls when there's going to be war, and they're war souls. In the Bhagavad Gita, the Hindu gospel, which is the equivalent of our New Testament, Krishna, which is the equivalent of the Christ incarnate in India, says to Arjuna, his disciple, to a warrior there is nothing more righteous than a noble war. Let me repeat that. To a warrior there is nothing more righteous than a noble war. Why? Because in the soul grouping that this person, this soul incarnated in, it was part of to be the destiny. To be the destiny that this was what they were here for. When 9/11 took place, I remember the Sunday after 9/11, I told people, and of course they looked at me peculiarly because I do make statements that obviously are somewhat peculiar. I told them, I said, those people incarnated for the purpose of dying on 9/11. Now, this is what I mean by the harshness of dealing with reality. They incarnated for a purpose. Now, it's going to have to be up to you to find out what that positive purpose is. But it is a positive purpose. Whether you consider it a wake-up call to what is taking place in the world, however you want to figure this out. The firemen that went in there after them, that lost their lives, same situation. All of this was supposed to happen. Notice one of the words in the affirmation says sacrificing. Sacrificing. There is no greater thing that one person can do than to lay their life down for another. And that is the truth. That's the greatest sacrifice of all. It's the greatest humanity of all. And so if those of you that put up your hands when I said about contracts a few moments ago, you stepped into this one. You're smiling. But you see, you can't go back on it, because if you believe it, there's a reason you believe it, because inside of you, deep down, intuitively, you know that this is so. Manner of exit. I recognize that nothing in this universe is by chance, and that the manner of exiting this life is predetermined, whether through natural, easy transition, long-term illness, accident, suicide, war, or tragedy. That pretty well covers all the bases. And that's the way it is. You don't say, well, there's an accident. It was an accident. That accident was down to the fine split second. And yet, if it wasn't supposed to be, it wasn't supposed to be. I think it was yesterday or the day before, with the storms that this country is having in the Midwest, they showed a baby was sitting in a car. I think the baby was 2 or 3 years old. And this giant tree fell on the car. Now, any of you that might have seen those pictures of that car would say, how could anything or anyone have lived? Because this car was really squashed. Yet the baby came out without a scratch. Coincidence? No. Nothing is by coincidence. That baby is supposed to live. What would have killed anybody else didn't kill that baby. That's what I'm talking about, the manner of exit. We pick that too. Everything is picked. You may not remember it, but stored in your unconscious right now, you have chosen how you're going to leave this earth and when you're going to leave this earth. The question is, if you keep living and living and living and living, are you contributing? Are you giving wisdom? Are you spreading cheer and love rather than hate? Are you living the ways of the world with deceit, with lies? Which so many people do, even those particularly that are in religion. And the metaphysical field, I might add, is not immune to that. Time of exit, I recognize that all in the universe is controlled by God's inner presence, and that the time when my soul or other souls depart is predetermined. There's only one life inside of your body. Everything else is make-believe personality. The only one life that you've got in your body is the life of the universe, i.e. God. God knows how long God wants to inhabit this body that you call Tom, Dick, or Harry. And it's down to the exact split second. You see, if everything wasn't down to the exact split second, this whole universe would be going through a continual, eternal Big Bang. Big Bang, Big Bang, Big Bang. I met a young man that worked for me for a few hours this past week. He's a math teacher in high school. He says, how much does math come into play in what you teach? I said, math is basically everything. This whole universe is so structured to the split second, to the split timing, that if everything wasn't so minutely timed,
that this whole universe would be constantly re-exploding. I said everything is according to music as well, that musical notes and mathematics all blend in, and this whole universe is structured, and our life and that mysterious thing that we call spirit, all of this is an interplay of all of these wonderful factors taking place down to the most minute thing. Now, if you can believe that, then how hard is it for a person to believe that perhaps their life is down to that split minute second, their manner of exit predetermined? It's all perfect clockwork. I found it rather amusing. The Dalai Lama has a hobby. Years ago, I mentioned this to maybe a few people in a lecture. The hobby of the Dalai Lama is collecting watches and timepieces. Why would a person be so moved to do this? Well, I know. That's been my hobby for a number of years. Because inside, there is a divine correspondence to everything that takes place outwardly. It's so said that Buddha, whenever he saw a rose, a physical rose, would go into a swoon. Why did he go into a swoon? Because it reminded him in a higher state of consciousness how he had seen this flowery blossom open, and he knew immediately that it was his soul. You see, when you see things from the inside and the outside, and then let God's presence, that is your true life within you, find and achieve that state of balanced awareness, these things become evident to you. They become self-evident, God self-evident. Understanding, I recognize that the closer in oneness I am to God's presence within me, the greater my awareness of the why behind the length of people's lives, inclusive of my own. You don't know how many times over the years, the past decades that I've been at this, that so many older people have come up to me and said to me, and in great sincerity, you know, I'm still here, but for the life of me, I cannot figure out why I'm still here. I mean, I'm retired. I don't seem to do anything. I don't seem to really contribute anything. And I've tried to explain to them, there's a reason you're still here. It isn't by coincidence. It isn't by chance. You're a contributor. You're giving something. You may not be consciously aware of what you're giving. It might be that if you pass somebody in the old folks' home and you just say good morning, that's it. That's all it takes, because that might be the only good morning and the only smile that that soul will get. You are contributing. The least little thing, you are a contributor. One smile. One acknowledgement, one inkling of giving a person the feeling that you care, being a real friend, not an acquaintance, genuinely caring when someone is hurting or in need, immediately responsive. You see somebody hurting, what can I do? And it isn't that you're saying, what can I do, because you're a goody two-shoes, or it tells you so in the Bible, or anybody else has told you so under the guise of religion. It's because the God inside of you instantly puts everything else aside. What can I do? You're a contributor. You're giving. There's a reason you're here. A reason you're still present. So all of you, that maybe some of you have a few gray hairs on their head like I do, just realize There's a reason. I'm here. You're here. And everyone else is here, whether they be one day old or 100 years old. Let's take now for a few moments, sit back in our chairs, and enter into a state of meditation for a few moments. I turn away from the outer world for a few moments to turn inward to the inner world that exists within me, a world of mind, a world of consciousness, a world of greater reality. And so I move the outer part of my mind inward to begin to explore the inner recesses of consciousness within me. To look within, deep within, the higher reality of who and what I am. To turn my senses inward, that I may begin to perceive and see into the deepest recesses of my own mind. And so I move moment by moment and breath by breath, traveling inward, inward to a higher state of beingness and reality, a higher state of awareness and of knowingness. I move from the physical to the non-physical, from the outer to the inner, from the temporary to the permanent. From the seeming to the light. For here, at the center of my beingness, is the light of God's presence within me, and yet infinitely beyond me. I am part of the eternal presence, the spirit of the Almighty. I am part of that which is without beginning and without ending. I seem to be born. I seem to die. But all of this is only seeming, only an illusion of my outer senses. For my soul, one with the eternal spirit, is ever present, always part of the eternal life that is God. In this inner reality, I therefore find peace, harmony between my soul and the spirit of eternal life. I am in that presence that always is. Nothing in any physical lifetime can extinguish my eternal reality in my oneness with God. I am in this Christed mind awareness of my highest reality, that indeed the Father, Mother God of the universe and I are inseparably, eternally one. I sit for a few moments in a state of quiet and peace to feel the reality of that which I am, that I am.
In a few moments, I'll begin to open my eyes and my senses to the outer world once again. But I will retain a sense of sacredness and holiness that exists within myself, in the presence and spirit of God, that will intuitively guide me and direct me in a loving way and in a healing way in all that I say, do, and am in this physical life. And so now, ever so slowly, I'll begin to open my eyes. And as I open my eyes, I'll stretch my arms and hands high over my head in a symbolic gesture of always reaching for something higher, knowing that that something higher that I reach for is to be found in the height of who and what I truly am within myself, a living, breathing manifestation of the stars, of the heavens, of universal life, having taken image, shape, form, and embodiment. And I bring my hands now, resting in this highest truth that I am that which I am, giving thanks that it is so, and so it is.